Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you all know, this evening we have Mr. Manoj Joshi talking to us, revisiting a book on Kashmir which he wrote now almost a quarter of a century back, roughly. The period that he had covered in his book, I was just speaking to him a little while ago. I had read his book about the time it was published. And it ends up around 98, commencing from about the time that militancy, terrorism first surfaced in the valley. That's around, say, roughly 88 to 98. Now, I don't need to speak excessively about his credentials. He's one of our senior members. I have personally known him for about 3 decades when he was a very young, active media person. And then he pursued higher studies, became an academic, started teaching. But his heart was always more inclined towards understanding and commenting on some of these strife-torn areas. And I remember his covering Punjab in the old days and Kashmir when I was in the defense ministry and later in the home ministry. He has covered these areas for a very long time. Now, coming back to the book, he will be talking to us and giving us a perspective in the current context. I believe he will do that. And then comes the question, what happened then when he finished his writing his book and it was published, well received? What has happened in the interregnum of over 20 years and more? And what is it that we haven't done or could have done? I'm looking forward to hear Manoj speak about this. Manoj, all yours now.
Thank you, sir. As Mr. Vohra said, our connection goes back a very long time ago. I started my interest in this area began with Punjab because the terrorist movement began in Punjab in the mid-80s. And I was a journalist and I would cover it. And I wrote a paper on that. And coincidentally, the paper was published in a London journal in 1993, just about when the Punjab terrorism got its death blow. After writing that paper, I wrote a paper. I was working in the United States for 2 years for an Indian newspaper. So I started working on a paper on the LTTE and how it functioned in India and Tamil Nadu, how the LTTE built up its network in Tamil Nadu. And that paper was also published by a journal on conflict and terrorism by the, which is a journal of the RAND Corporation. And then I thought that I would also do something on Kashmir. And I met the, I happened to meet David Devidar, who was the publisher of Penguin, and he said, why do you want to do a academic paper? Why don't you write a book? Now, that was a very ambitious thing, and I was at that time actually physically in the United States, but I managed to collect a lot of material, come back. After I came back to India, I worked on this book. Now, I'll just quickly describe this book and then come to the context of the present. So this book, as Vohra Saab said, covers the first decade of what I call the rebellion. Lost Rebellion, that's the title of the book. And the thing about this is that when the rebellion actually broke out, one of the features was that no one actually knew what was happening. Meaning the government of India fumbled for a policy. And you can't blame the government of India. 1989, if you recollect, Rajiv Gandhi lost the majority in parliament. VP Singh became the Prime Minister. There was political instability in this country. In fact, separately elsewhere, I have described 1991 as perhaps one of the worst years that this country could have seen, because if you remember, our gold had to be pledged in London. One of our former prime ministers was assassinated. So a lot of things were happening, and simultaneously the Kashmir and Punjab were on the boil. So you can imagine how it was, and the government of India was pretty hard-pressed. Their response was fumbling. Partly it was a kind of a military response. Partly what they did was they got the border security force, which was actually doing basically border guarding duties, and dumped them in Srinagar and said, now you look after this. And so they had to learn the hard way. What do you do? And there was no strategy. No one had a strategy as to how you're going to take on these militants. The Pakistanis had been planning well, and almost because the Pakistanis were involved in the American jihad in Afghanistan. And so the Americans and the Saudis were supplying the money. The ISI was channeling the money to these various Afghan militant groups. Lots of weapons, the whole place was awash with weapons, but the ISI kept that control. And the ISI never forgot that at the end of the day, if you're Pakistani, your target was Kashmir. So right from 84 onwards, even before before the Soviets were thinking of pulling out, the Pakistanis were planning the Kashmir venture. And the problem for them was that they couldn't get anyone in Kashmir. I'm not going to go into the history of what is happening. Sheikh Abdullah passed away. Farooq succeeded him. Farooq had problems with the Congress. Then the Congress knocked him out and got his brother-in-law in. And he said, all that, I'm not going to go into that. What the Pakistanis were up to. So Pakistanis first tried to get the organization which is closest to them, which is the Jamaat Islami Jammu Kashmir, JIJK. So you have the different Jamaat Islami, Jamaat Islami Hind, Jamaat Islami Jammu and Kashmir, Jamaat Islami Azad Kashmir, and Jamaat Islami Pakistan. These are separate organizations. And the JIJK, Maulana Saaduddin, he went there and they were talking with the Pakistanis. But the Maulana was a cautious person, and he didn't want to commit his cadre to some venture like that. Fortunately for the Pakistanis, the JKLF was active, the Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front, Yasin Malik and company. They wanted Amanullah Khan. So they began this. They said that we will take up the challenge. And so with the ISI organizing it, they started utilizing the chaotic situation that is there in Kashmir, the political crisis in Kashmir. So you had bomb blasts and you had some minor actions. So this was 84, 85, 86, 87. And then 88, by the time they had some trained people who could fire guns. But, you know, it was kind of pretty raw. Some of those young trained kids, they could barely aim and fire straight with the AK-47. But whatever it is, the problem was that this crisis, this JKLF thing combined with the political crisis in India. And that political crisis got compounded when the Union Home Minister's daughter was kidnapped, Rubia Saeed. She was kidnapped in Srinagar. And all the contemporary accounts, and I must say to Farooq Abdullah's credit, he said, look, don't worry, they will have to release her. Social pressure will be such that they can't hold her. But the problem is that New Delhi thought it knew better. And so they eventually pressured Farooq into releasing those four JKLF militants who were captive. And once they were released, for the first time, the Kashmiris felt that we have defeated New Delhi. And so their whole place exploded. This is the beginning of the whole thing. The whole place exploded. There was chaos. Governor resigned. Another governor was sent. Jagmohan was sent. Jagmohanji, of course, a familiar figure for all of us IIC members. So he was sent there. So when he was sent, the police there, the CRPF and the police, they felt that Jagmohan is a very strict governor. So he will ask us what we've been doing. So we must do something. So they went and to the Batmalu area, and they used their dandas and beat up a lot of people and arrested a lot of people. That created an even bigger furor. So on the day that Jagmohan came, and he describes this in his book, and in his book, the Indian state has essentially had lost Srinagar. The police and everything had vanished. Jagmohanji landed up from the airport. There were no police, no bandobas, nothing was there. And it is then that he called General Zaki, and they said, we must enforce the curfew. So the army was sent out with the CRPF. They enforced the curfew. There was firing. Anywhere between 20 to 100 people died in that what's called the Gaukadal massacre. But that brought the temperature immediately down. That mass of people who had arisen, that mass didn't come back for a long time after that. We only see that mass demonstration, mass protests happening much later in the mid 2000s when the stone pelting and all this begins. But in between, it had been hard guerrilla warfare. And that guerrilla warfare is what I describe in this book. In this book, what I describe is tactics, what kind of tactics the army employed, what kind of tactics the BSF employed, how the Jammu and Kashmir police, which had collapsed. There was even a protest. Jammu and Kashmir police were completely sidelined. And this was the difference between Jammu and Kashmir police and the Punjab, this thing. In Punjab, once the police was revitalized, they came from the same people, they were the local people, but the police played a key role in eventually defeating the terrorism. In Jammu and Kashmir, it took a much longer time because Jammu and Kashmir has a different kind of an environment. And plus, we should not forget that there was the role of the ISI. Sometimes we tend to underplay it. Yes, there was popular support for the rebellion. But if you just look at the kind of support that is provided by Pakistan, so I had got some figures, and you know, you could see that between 1988 and July of 1998, 20,000 AK-47s had been recovered. 20,000, which is, you know, can equip a division and a half of the army. So this is the scale of support that was being provided. But this is just AK-47. They were kind of 9,000, 10,000 pistols and revolvers, light machine guns. So Pakistan was pumping in money, was pumping in weaponry into this. So first the JKLF came up. So to come back to that story, the JKLF started the process, but Pakistanis weren't happy. Pakistan knew that they wanted the movement to go towards the merger with Pakistan. So for that, they needed the Jamaat-Islami, the Jamaat-Islami cadre, what eventually the militant organizations, they grouped together, the Islamist organization, which became the Hizbul Mujahideen. And the JKLF was actually... in some instances, actually, they betrayed JKLF people to the Indian authorities. So JKLF was virtually neutralized right at the beginning. Hizbul Mujahideen became the dominant thing. And then the struggle between the Indian security forces and the Hizbul Mujahideen, the BSF leading the charge with a gentleman who's no longer there. He has passed away. Inspector General of Police, Ashok Patel, played a heroic role in recovering. He recreated an entire intelligence wing for the BSF called the G branch. There was a G branch in the BSF, but it didn't have much experience. So they got captured militants, turned them around, used them to get more information, and penetrated the groups, different groups. So all this battle happened, but by 1994 it became clear that the Kashmiri part of the militancy was over. They no longer had. They had been their weapons had been captured. They had many of them had been thousands of them had been arrested, killed, etc. And I must say, this was a brutal war. I have described in this book all the human rights excesses, the torture. There was a lot of torture, etc., etc. Everything was taking place. It was all such insurgencies are essentially dirty wars. If anyone says they can fight it cleanly, you know, I think they are mistaken. But by 1994, that is over. So now what did the Pakistanis do? By that time, the Soviet part was over. The Soviet Union had withdrawn from Afghanistan. So the Pakistanis systematically started sending in their people. They had sent some Afghans earlier, but those Afghans didn't work out in Kashmir Valley. They sent, two dozen, three dozen Afghans. In fact, at various times, there were various foreign militants in Afghanistan, in Kashmir, which includes people from Somalia, Eritrea, Chechnya, Turkey, etc. But the real tough fighters who came eventually were the Pakistani Punjabis, meaning these are the Lashkar-e-Tayyaba and the what became the Jaish-e-Mohammed, the various groupings that became the Jaish-e-Mohammed. And so 98, but what happened was by 96, as I said, some amount of normalcy had been restored. We were able to hold elections. And the government was able to restore the political process. Chief Minister came back. There was representation of the, meaning MPs and MLAs were there. So the Pakistanis then, as I said, one stream of their gamble was to send in their foreign militants. And in 98, there are at least six instances where there are mass killings of the Hindus. Hindus in Doda area, where many of these Pakistani Punjabis operate. And all these were done by these Pakistani Punjabi mercenaries, if I may call them that. There were several. So they stepped up violence sharply in the valley. The second move was Kargil. By the getting into Kargil, they completely disrupted the security grid in the Kashmir Valley. Army had to move mountain division towards Kargil to fight the Pakistanis there. And so there was a lot of disruption. And so we see in the 2000s, now this is after the period of my book, where we see even greater violence. 500, 600 security personnel being killed in a year, meaning our personnel. But the fortunately, what had happened was that the electoral process had taken off. In 2002 election, I recollect going to Kashmir. It turned out to, by even locals said, it was one of the fairest elections that had taken place. I'm now not going to go into the various stories as to how hard people like Vohra Sahab was there. He had been appointed interlocutor, I think, sir, at that time. And how hard the government of India worked, how hard the Vajpayee government worked. They offered ceasefire. There was massacre from the other side. So the normal technique would be that the government would reach out and the other side would create mayhem, meaning the ISI side. This was a pattern. And then we come to 2004. I'm not going to the Agra summit and all this kind of thing. 2004 is the Islamabad SAARC summit. And it is the sidelines of that summit that Vajpayee ji and Musharraf made a deal. Basically, they said that we will discuss all issues. We will have this so-called composite dialogue on various issues. And just before that, Musharraf had declared ceasefire along the entire line of control. Now, if you go back and look at the statistics from 96, 97 down to almost 2003, the line of control was a violent, violent place. Bombardment, machine gun firing, because that was the technique that Pakistanis used to infiltrate people in, that you fire in one area and the infiltrators come in from there. And the 2003 ceasefire was extremely significant. That actually began to change things there. And 2004 to 2007, I would say, was the period of opportunity. Period of opportunity where the Pakistani, where Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, by that time Manmohan Singh had become Prime Minister, he told the Pakistanis bluntly that, his famous words that, I have not become Prime Minister to change the borders. That we are willing to do a deal as long as there's no change of borders, but we can make the borders soft. And this happened, but unfortunately, what happened was that by 2007, Musharraf himself lost credibility. He was undermined, then he was replaced, his successors as general, because then the key was that Musharraf had been both head of government and the army chief, Pakistan army chief. And Pakistan, as you know, is famously political authority is divided, meaning you have the army chief has his own say, and sometimes actually the veto. The army chief has a veto on Indian policy, and the head of government. But when the person was the same, he was able to push through certain policy. And the Pakistani army system is such that it has it displays what is called corporate behavior, in the sense that they all go along with the whoever the chief is, the all the core commanders by and large back him. You know, they don't take it. There's no instance where they have replaced him or something like that. He's the boss at that time. He's the boss. Once he retires, someone else comes. That's a different issue. But after that, that moment was lost. But sufficient peace, the violence, that old militant violence had come down fairly drastically. So then we saw, because we were not able to clinch any kind of a political settlement, we saw the return of the crowd. The crowd came as young people out into the street. Some of them must have been children, infants when the rebellion had broken out. So the stone pelting and that kind of thing started happening, which I would say is something called is violent civil protest. It is civil protest, but violent civil protest. It's not armed militancy. So you need to distinguish in this. What, in my view, what we needed was a different kind of police personnel to deal with it. We have seen riot control police in different countries. If you ever have an opportunity to go to YouTube, look at riot control police in Korea, how the Korean police dealt with their violent civil protests. You'll find in many Western countries, now you've seen what is happening in France, you will see that they are also equally violent, meaning they are no less violent than what you'd find in Kashmir Valley. Stone pelting, throwing petrol bombs, etc., etc., at the police. This riot police is trained precisely for that and equipped and has sufficient this thing so that they are able to protect themselves. They wear down the crowd. Their technique is to wear down the mob. We did not do anything of the sort. We used the same people. So the result was, and the same people, but they had this, all they had was guns. And with guns, you can control a mob only by shooting at them. So the problem is that we were not able to deal with that effectively as we should have. That, of course, that is just the technical problem of policing. Second problem was the political problem. I think that is equally important. I think Manmohan Singh Ji, he tried. He had these round tables. There was the issue of autonomy. In my view, as far as Kashmir is concerned, now I'm not going to go into the history. We know that accession, you know, the Delhi Agreement, Article 370, Constitution of Kashmir, etc., etc. There is also the reality. The reality is that, yes, Kashmiris say we want autonomy. Now, you want autonomy. Do you want the Election Commission to be also Kashmiri? Do you want the Supreme Court of Kashmir to be Kashmiri? Then it will be even more biased. I mean, in a small place like Kashmir, if the Supreme Court also comes from the same elite and the Election Commission comes from the same elite, so in fact there are aspects of autonomy which are better served when the Supreme Court is in New Delhi or the Election Commission is in New Delhi. The point I'm trying to make is that what we have on offer, in the sense that what we need to do or what governments in India need to do, is to address not a reality, because the Kashmiri, in my view, just like all of us, we have sufficient autonomy. In a country like India, we can study where we want. You want to study in Harvard, if you've got the money or if you've got the brains, you can go and study in Harvard. You can go and attend a madrasa if you want. You can go to Deoband and go to the seminary there. So all those are not the issue. Meaning your practical freedom, you elect your person who governs you, that is also there. But in Kashmir, the challenge is of addressing a sentiment. There is a sentiment in the minds of a Kashmiri elite that I'm missing something. When you try and pin down what exactly you're missing, it's more difficult, meaning it's not, you don't get a straightforward answer. That's why when the word Azadi is used, it doesn't quite mean independence. And even Kashmiris will say that they don't quite really say that we'll be, because after all, an area which is 120 kilometers by 40 kilometers is hardly, can hardly become independent. It will be independent for half a day. Meaning when the Pakistanis will come pouring across from Uri again, the independence will be gone in half a day. There's no question of that entity being independent. But the important thing is to address the sentiment. Now, sentiments are addressed. How are they addressed? Pandit Nehru addressed them. He said Article 370. He addressed them by saying, ab apna jhanda laga lo. So the Kashmir has its own flag. You see, Kashmir would call initially. They would call their chief minister prime minister. So these were all ways of addressing the sentiment. I still think that when it comes to political settlement, it is important to finesse it, in such a way that the Kashmiri feels that he has, that after, you know, kind of 30, 40,000 people dying of this long and terrible period that of Kashmiri history, that we can say that yes, we have won. Everyone must feel that they have won. The Indian state must also feel that it has won. Now, that is one part of it. There is a second equally important part of it, which is Pakistan. Now, no matter what you do, you cannot ignore Pakistan. Why? Because, and most Indians sometimes don't seem to realize this, almost all the countries of the world recognize Kashmir as a disputed area. They do not recognize Kashmir as being part of India. This is the legal position. As far as Kashmir is concerned, in the views of most of the international community. So we need to address that issue. We need to settle that issue once and for all. And Pakistan, for a variety of reasons, again, I don't want to go into this thing, has developed, for the sake of its own identity, has developed a kind of an obsessive, almost neurotic interest, saying that Kashmir is ours. Whereas actually Pakistan has a zero, in my view, has a zero case as far as the accession is concerned. We were all, you know, parts of the British Empire. It is the British Independence of India Act 1947 through which this Republic of India has emerged, and the Republic of Pakistan, Islamic Republic of Pakistan, has emerged. It's not, it is not that there was always an India and always a Pakistan. That's not true. We were created by that. And if you look at that act very carefully, very clearly, the princely states were left out of the whole thing. And the princely states were told, you join either one of the two. And Mr. Jinnah, who later on, you know, who's the founder of Pakistan, don't forget, he accepted the accession of Junagadh in September of 1947. If indeed it was true that religion was the basis on which accession was supposed to take place, then how come he accepted the accession of Junagadh, where 80% or even more percent of the population was Hindu? So you see, but the problem is that when you talk to Pakistanis, all that part is brushed away. That Kashmir was meant to be ours. So, in my view, but the point is that for a variety of reasons, again, I don't want to go into all that. The issue went up to the United Nations, where it was recognized as a kind of an international dispute, and we've got to fix that. that has to be fixed before this thing. And that can be, and over time, Simla agreement, et cetera, we have come to the conclusion that it can only be fixed through bilateral dialogue between India and Pakistan. My view is that that bilateral process and the process of addressing the sentiment of the people in the valley must go together. It must be synchronized carefully, because if one goes ahead, the other, it becomes a lag. The other becomes a drag on the process. If you don't take the Kashmiris with you and you settle with Pakistan, it won't do. And if you settle with the Kashmiris and don't settle with Pakistan, it's not going to work. Because they have shown that the capacity of increasing the violence. Now, short of defeating Pakistan, like you defeated Pakistan in Bangladesh, I don't think you're going to get a situation where they're going to sign on the dotted line and say, we agree that Kashmir is part of India. So the Manmohan Singh process was taking you in the right direction. And it has set a level. In my view, it has set the level, though Pakistanis today reject it. Pakistan said, no, that's Manmohan Singh thing is over. That 4-point process, that is over. But that's not true. Because what other option do they have? Militarily, they can't do anything. Meaning militancy actually dramatically declined. Till 2011, it had dramatically declined, and it had reached the point where I think in that particular year, and I'm talking from memory, some 11 or 12 security personnel alone were killed. But since 2014 onwards, and this I must say with this government, and I can say it because, you know, I'm a free individual, that this government had a certain history behind it. There is a reason. It's not something which what their policy is driven by their own political view. And their political view, because this government is from the BJP, and the BJP itself antecedents are from the Jansang. The Jansang itself has come from the Praja Parishad. And Praja Parishad as an organization opposed autonomy to Kashmir. It came up, the organization, the Praja Parishad came up as an organization fighting the notion that Kashmir should have any kind of special status. So it is, the BJP definitely does not consider the idea of a special status to Kashmir. So what do you negotiate? What is the political? So the approach of the government has been what is, this thing exemplified by the word Operation All Out. That means crush the insurgency, crush the Kashmiri sentiment, crush the Kashmiri opinion. That there is no room for any kind of political dialogue, that we do not agree. We do not accept the notion of any kind of autonomy, any kind of political, that you do not have a special status. So that has been the basic approach of the government. And as far as Pakistan is concerned, of course, Pakistan has been more of a political opportunity rather than a country that you deal with. But that doesn't resolve the problem, because as I said, no country in the world recognizes Kashmir to be a part of India. They say it's a disputed territory, and that has to be fixed. So we are in a situation where we don't know where we are going. What we have seen in the last couple of years has been the rise of local insurgency. In fact, the Pakistani factor has gone down. The Pakistani militant, the Jaish and all these, they do these big operations like Pulwama, so they have their people there. They are they get shelter there. They lie low most of the time. But when they have to make a statement, in quote, then they carry out single operation. But when it comes to separatism, insurgency, etc., now a lot of it is being done by the locals. And these are locals, in any study shows that most of these are people who are being driven by emotion more than anything else. There's often a statement that they are being driven by Islamist ideas and this and that, but actually local studies have shown a lot of the recruitment now, they don't even, it's difficult for them to get weapons from Pakistan. It's no longer, because the line of control has become pretty lethal. The India has fenced it. We have a very lethal cordon there. Getting weapons and equipment is tough. So many of these young people that Burhan Wani and all this, I asked someone, I said, Burhan Wani, tell me one action in which we actually took part. And no one gave me an answer, because Burhan Wani was okay posing with a gun in a orchard dressed in combat fatigues. But I wonder if any of these young people did anything. Some of them don't even know how to shoot that with those weapons too well, and that whole group has been eliminated. That the group that was posing with him in the orchard. But the problem is that how do we deal with these young people? These young people who, because of emotion, sentiment, they get into this mood for this insurgency, and we have to find the ways and means, and frankly not many ideas are around. Just to say that we'll put them all in jail, crush them, defeat them, it's not that simple. It's not that simple. Because there is a sentiment there, there are views there, there are sentiments which have been shaped by history. I was just reviewing a manuscript from anonymous reviewer of a manuscript on Kashmir, which virtually argued from the intellectual point of view that Kashmir has evolved as a nation. I don't agree with that, by the way. But all I'm trying to say is there's a sentiment. There are sentiments there which need to be dealt with effectively. And I'm not sure, given the way the policy has been coming in the last so many years, which way it'll go. So do you think I should know, and then we can have some discussion. Yeah. I think I've had my say, and I'd be more than happy to respond to any questions.
Idhar lao. Microphone now. Aap boliye.
Thank you for such an actually, I find there is a contradiction in what you say. You say that Pakistan has zero case on Kashmir, and at the same time you say that internationally it's a international community believes that it is a dispute. So how do you reconcile that? And secondly, I want to say that government of India is pumping money like anything, like Modi government in Kashmir for building infrastructure, roads or railways or even airports and airlines, like Northeast, what they are doing, look east policy. So and there is the issue of Kashmiri pandits. There is a lot of, at the end of the day, it is a never-ending problem as I see it. Maybe I am a pessimist or realist, whatever you may like to call. So can there be a solution? It is a very vexed and complicated issue, and which...
you made your point.
Thank you.
Who else wants to speak?
Yes, sir, can I have the microphone?
Either though, better.
You haven't told us anything about the newness of the new edition. How has it evolved, and what makes it different from the earlier edition? And have your views changed or evolved in the course of in the intervening years?
Could you tell the first one?
We didn't get you.
Repeat it. Okay. The newness of the new edition. What makes it different from the old, and how have your views evolved or changed in the intervening years?
I have only one point to make. Of course, all the accessions which were done post-independence were under that British Act under which the whatever freedom was given. The same act, the same thing was signed with the Maharaja Hari Singh when those people came and invaded the territory of J&K, and the army went and they controlled. Now, you are saying it's a bilateral thing, but how it is bilateral? For two reasons. One, the matter was taken to United Nations by India, not by Pakistan. So we have taken the matter to Pakistan, to United Nations. And the resolution, which is unanimously passed, has only 3 points. Point number one, Pakistan will vacate, which it has not done in last so many years. So once Pakistan, which is a unanimous party to the United Nations resolution of which is passed by the all countries unanimously. Now, all those countries have never even once asked Pakistan to vacate that POK. That's one point. The second and third point starts when the first starts. Now, the first has not started, which is a multilateral issue. That's one. Second, having taken that POK, keeping it till date, despite the UN resolution, Pakistan has given a part of it to China, which was then not even a permanent member or any member of the United Nations when this resolution had gone. But China came into existence in 1950, the way today we see the China. No country objected, and that piece of land, they have made a highway, they are making everything, and they are the security is of China, the army is of China in that piece of land. That is the second issue. So from multilateral to trilateral, it is now you are saying it's a bilateral issue. Now, even if it is a bilateral issue, as you are saying, Bangladesh war happened in 71. 90,000 Pakistani soldiers were brought to India. Each and every Indian citizen has paid money for their food for 9 months for bringing them back into India. We paid in the form of 5 paisa postage stamp, everybody of us. India was not obliged to bring them into India. They could have remained in Bangladesh. They would have been charged for rape. They would have been charged for murder. They would have been executed or killed in Bangladesh. But India brought them. 9 months we kept them. We signed a Shimla agreement with them with unconditional release of those 90,000 without even asking our single prisoner of war or a fisherman which is in Pakistan's jail, simply because we wanted it to remain a bilateral thing. Now, how long we wanted bilateral? Thank you.
Well, you have given the entire alpha and omega of the Kashmir story. First thing is, Kashmir became part of India in the very same fashion at 565 princely states were accessed to India. In the same fashion, it became a part of India, like the rest of the 565 princely states, number one. Number two, if you can throw some light on the ceasefire line declaration, who ordered the ceasefire line in Jammu and Kashmir during this war? 1949 or whatever it was. So whose order the ceasefire was declared in Jammu and Kashmir? Was it Nehru? Was it Abdullah? Or was it army? If you have any background, you know, to this clue.
Right.
I don't need it, I can just say. Okay. So I have a couple of points. Firstly, you know, regarding we saying that in this issue we have to consider Pakistan also. So that means what you're trying to say is India has to talk to Pakistan. Well, frankly, I feel, and why I say that is that I have studied in JNK. My father was in army as a brigade commander in Baramulla district. I have traveled in that whole area as a youngster. I have seen written there, India go out and all those kind of slogans. Today, after so many years, it is the first time, whether right or wrong, this people have to check, but it says that Baramulla is the first district in JNK which is terrorist free and all that. And very rightly so also, because if one looks at it, the number of people who have applied for joining of armed forces from that district is the highest in the whole of JNK. So which is again an achievement for the government. But having had that background of, you know, practically seeing and facing what is happening there, even in my first job I used to travel to JNK, and one of my dealers who used to be in Lal Chowk, he told me, he says, Kiji, aap abhi to aa gaye ho, agli dafa aapko visa leke aana hoga, aap aaiye kahwa pijiye. So this was the kind of mindset. This I am telling you, I passed out my MBA 86-88 batch. This was in 89. That is the time this incident happened there. So all that mahol which was getting created and all that. Unfortunately, first and foremost, I feel all governments, irrespective, all political parties, irrespective whether they are communist or rightist or leftist or so-called centrist, whatever it is, they all must have a unified brain on this. Whether they are going to talk with Pakistan on this or they're going to solve it on their own, that is one, first and foremost, they must sit together and sort this out. Because everybody sings a different song. No, sir, one minute, just give me a minute, sir. Secondly, as far as Pakistan is concerned, I think we can still do away with them in this discussion because over a period, internationally, countries have said, this is between India and Pakistan, we have got nothing to do with it. They are not, including the big five powers, they are also not getting involved into it. And very recently also we have seen where people, including China, have just said, keep restraint without any issues on it. So which shows that if the government is strong or if we are strong, these guys will behave. Otherwise, as far as Pakistan is concerned, I have traveled to Pakistan a few times, sir, and I am telling you, their whole wajood is based on India-Pakistan thing. It's not like us. Thirdly, our Indian army works on a high moral ground. They are not like Pakistan army. If they would have been like Pakistan army, this problem would have got sorted out long time back. So which, fortunately for a democratic setup, we've got a very good army to support the country. But our politicians and our successive governments have not been supporting the army on this. So we have to really, if we want to solve this, we have to have a velvet glove with an iron fist if you want to solve this problem. Otherwise, we will just keep talking aman ki asha. We will keep doing, you know, various all those stunts, political stunts, and no solution will come to this.
Thank you very much. Yes, madam.
I too have a personal viewpoint because I have family members who are Khals and their children who have grown up in New Delhi don't speak a word of Kashmiri, hardly go there or maybe have never gone there, say, we were never part of India. Why don't most Indians, majority of whom are Hindu, realize that Hari Singh and the Dogras never wanted to be part of India? It wasn't just the mass of the Muslim population who didn't have a word in at that time. It was Hari Singh and the Dogras. Okay, secondly, in 2002 I went as part of a very large group of observers to see the election, and I particularly chose to go to Baramulla and Sopor because Sopor had been burnt 3 times by the BSF. It's not just the army, our great disciplined army. We have rogues in the Rashtriya Rifles, in the BSF, in the CRPF. The BSF reports have never been published, the rapes in Shopian and things like that. And I personally saw educated young men, young boys, coming back from college or school, being made to do sit-ups, you know, hold your ears and sit up and down by just any jawan of the CRPF, simply because they didn't have the pass with them to pass a certain bridge or go into a certain road. So this humiliation the youth have been subject to, much before the pellet gun started blinding people, this hasn't been addressed by anyone in the media even. And finally, I feel that China now has a very huge vested interest because of its interest in Gwadar and, you know, keeping... I have a feeling there's a part that China is playing in keeping this issue alive and burning.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you. Thank you for those questions. I think the first thing was about the question of the Pakistan's kind of locus standi. I think that on the whole thing. See, it's not my view. My view, actually, as I told you very clearly, I think that Pakistan doesn't have a case. But you see, that's only my view. The problem is that the way the international system works is that we went to the United Nations with a complaint, but that is where the problem arose. And I think if you really want to understand, there's a our former diplomat Chandrasekhar Das Gupta has written a very fine book which showed how the whole thing was twisted out of shape, and it was made into an India-Pakistan issue, meaning the what the United Nations considered was not India's complaint of aggression. That is what we went with. We went with India's complaint of aggression, saying that these people have invaded the place. But what the United Nations Security Council did was that they converted it into the so-called India-Pakistan issue. And in that India-Pakistan issue, yes, they passed those resolutions. Three resolutions. The final resolution basically said that Pakistan must vacate, and after it vacates, there should be a plebiscite there. So that the UN, then that plebiscite never happened. It couldn't, you know, we are now talking of 1947, 48, 49. The whole concept of plebiscite in a state which had never had an election. I mean, say the plebiscite was a European product which happened after World War II. There are certain parts of Europe were decided by plebiscite, but Europe was a different. They were all educated people. They had elections in the past, etc. So the idea of transposing this onto the Indian context, you can imagine. Meaning, till recently, even elections were a tough. Anyone who knows elections in India in the early 80s, you know that in Bihar, booth capturing was normal. Meaning, there were large parts of Bihar where you couldn't have a fair election. So Kashmir in 1947, if you thought that you could have a plebiscite, was impossible. But it's just that European thing was transposed here. We were just a very new country, young country. Our armies were also not commanded by us. They were commanded by the British. The British commanded the Pakistan army. The British commanded the Indian army. The British, in their own way, actually ran this campaign in a very careful way. The British, someone asked about the ceasefire. Why did it come about? And one of the reasons was that because General Kariyappa was going to take over as the chief of the Indian Army, and the British wanted to ensure that India would not, and there is enough evidence now that the Indians were planning the offensive towards, you know, liberating those areas of Muzaffarabad and those areas, Mirpur and those areas. But the British didn't want us there. They thought that that will be the buffer for Pakistan. So right from the beginning, and I think also from Nehru's point of view, and this is the unsaid thing, is that basically Nehru thought that just like India, maybe Pakistan will agree to a partition of the state. That the existing lines where they were neatly divided that part of Jammu and Kashmir, which was not really Kashmiri. Meaning that Mirpur and that area, there are not Kashmiri-speaking people there. Those people are ethnically closer to the Pakistanis. And this same sentiment was there in the 71, 72 Simla Agreement, where you know that the episode where we released those 90,000 prisoners, and we got a verbal assurance from Bhutto that the ceasefire line, first of all, would be renamed as the line of control, and eventually line of control would become the international border. So this idea that the existing borders will be frozen has been the longer range strategy, but we can't say this as an opening gambit, meaning when you negotiate something, you don't put down your final bargaining position at the first instance. So, by and large, the Indians would be perfectly happy if it was partitioned exactly where it is, because you certainly don't want very difficult characters like the Mirpuris, you know, the people who live in that area to be part of the Jammu and Kashmir state. It would be a practical problem, I can assure you. The second thing, a question I was asked about the new and old militancy, I think.
You're releasing a new edition of the book.
Oh, okay. Why the?
Think what is new in the new one?
Okay, what is new in the new one?
Yeah,
I'll tell you what is new. Why this happened? The reason is that in 98, when this was published, and then the Kargil thing happened, then there was a change in the militancy. The militancy took on a different kind of a twist. But increasingly, in the last couple of years, I have been feeling that things are going again back to the 90s. We are seeing more bloodshed. We are seeing similar kind of repression in this thing. So at that point, I felt that my publishers felt that maybe we would like, they would get queries, for the book, that we would like to reprint it. So they said, can you revise it? I said, I can't, because the 10 years, because to encapsulate 20 more years in a book which covered 10 years would be impossible. So what I did was that I wrote an additional chapter which covers the 2000 to 2018 period, and kind of an aftermath overview chapter, and have kind of published the original book, original pagination. And of course, I'm happy to report to you that it's selling well. So that means there was a demand for it. So I have just received my first royalty, check from the publisher. So I think there was a this thing. So that was the I think UN resolutions, I have already referred to it. Bilateral issue. You see, the thing with Pakistan and India. So the problem is that once it is there in the UN's books, and it remains in the UN's books, it has not been closed in the UN's books. Now, every time, I think from almost 30 years ago, no, not 30, I think maybe 25 years ago, Pakistan again tried to raise this, and Kofi Annan told them very bluntly, saying that, look, don't get us into this. Because you have to see what the UN, what effort the UN has made. The UN, as I said, they put the three resolutions from between 1947, between 1950 to 1956, repeated, they tried mediation, they tried all kinds of things, nothing worked. In 1963, the Anglo-Americans, under Anglo-American auspices, there was mediation. There were five meetings between India and Pakistan, and they sat down to this thing. It didn't work. So the world community says that, look, it's that while we do not accept that Jammu and Kashmir is part of India or part of Pakistan, you people fix it. We don't want to get involved in this. You people fix it. And so the challenge is for, and we ourselves have said in the Simla agreement that it will be done, dealt with bilaterally. So that commitment is our commitment. It's not some commitment made this thing. So we have said that we will try and fix it bilaterally. Now there was you said about the 565 states of India. See, but this was the only state where at the time of accession, the head of government, which is the Lord Mountbatten, made a public commitment that there would be a plebiscite. No. Nehru, the discussion between when the accession was accepted, the discussion between Nehru and Mountbatten took place. Mountbatten said, I will only accept it if there is a commitment to plebiscite. Then Nehru made the commitment. So that there was a commitment from that this thing. And of course, it is a public commitment. And then, of course, the UN resolution presses it further. I think this point was made about, whether we can ignore. See, the point is, and this point I'm making repeatedly, that while I think Pakistan does not have a case, you cannot simply say that the world community is not going to accept that. World community will not accept that Pakistan has no say. The world community, for the challenge to you from the world community is that you guys fix it. You guys fix it diplomatically. You guys go and talk to those people and fix it. And it's not unfixable. I think the experience of the 2004-2007 period is that it can be fixed. If Musharraf, General Musharraf, the president of Pakistan, chief of the Pakistan army, because they also know the reality, they know that they have thrown in everything they can. They have thrown in thousands of people, they have thrown in thousands of guns. It has not worked. They have made war on us in 1947, they made war in 1965. It hasn't worked. Now the question is, how do you finesse it? And finessing is the issue. This is, as I said, this is the challenge on us. This is the challenge for us. We are the bigger country. We are the more powerful country. It is. We have to manage this. How do we get the Pakistanis around? And I think Manmohan Singh did have something, and there was some movement there. It didn't work out. Maybe next time it will.
Sir, I'm sorry to interfere here. I don't think Pakistan will ever agree to this. Irrespective whether General Musharraf comes or Bajwa comes or anybody else comes, because like I said, the Pakistan army and the state of Pakistan wajood lies on this. If the moment this thing gets settled, Pakistan army will get relegated, the democratic setup will start increasing there. Nothing is going to happen there.
What I'm saying is,
look at where is General Musharraf today. He's living in Dubai. Why, if he was so strong and he had a say in the politics or in the army there, he should have been living in Rawalpindi or in Lahore. But the guy is not doing that. He is living there. Same.
There is a case of treason against him.
Sir, this is what Sir just told earlier, that the Pakistani army, all co-commanders get behind the general. That's a very smart move
general,
for them. That's a very smart move. Reason.
Of the day,
no,
of
no.
The day.
No, it's going to be always like that. That's a very smart move from the army echelon, because they know that by doing this, they will stay in power. They are not like those Middle Eastern crazy guys where one general will stand up and do a coup on the other and all that. They are much smarter than that. They are far more professional. But the moment they find that, yes, the problem is getting solved or can get solved, like in case of Musharraf, they packed him off to Dubai. And similarly, if tomorrow Bajwa does, he'll also get packed off. And this will continue,
you know,
sir.
I think that you have...
So we can't solve this problem. That's why I said we should not think that we are the big brothers. We've had enough of big brother story for all 70 years. We should not behave with them, because this is how their livelihood is.
See, I think you're...
Then what should we do?
I think you're perfectly...
Sir, my view is we have to solve this problem internally and just keep relegating Pakistan on the side.
Create...
No. Economically, we are doing a lot of... the amount of per capita money we are pumping into JNK is far more than other states.
Now, this is what needs
to be told to the people, and narrative has to be created.
Look, sir, you had your say. Now, that's the end of it. You are entitled to your views.
You see,
you want to say
recently, there has been a lot of talk about abrogating Article 370. And in this case, Mehbooba Mufti and Farooq Abdullah are on record having said that if Article 370 is abrogated, automatically the conditions on which Kashmir acceded to India, those conditions are whittled down and Kashmir ceases to be a part of India. Do you feel that the present government should take a risk of taking this step? To me, it appears more a populist move to show to people that we could do something which no other government has done, and which they stoke fire in a place which is already so explosive.
I think there is a technical issue there. The Article 370 can only be revoked by the Constituent Assembly of Kashmir. That Constituent Assembly was dissolved in 1956. So you would have to reconstitute a Constituent Assembly, and then, I don't know, meaning that whole thing looks a bit legally somewhat shaky. That's a different technical issue. The issue is really 370. Point about, you know, Pakistan, I wish, you know, Vajpayee ji, I think, had made this statement saying that, you know, if there is a neighbor there, I don't think, what can you do? You can build, we already have a wall, you see, we already have a wall. So, it is the challenge. I don't want to deal with Pakistan because I love Pakistan. I want to deal with Pakistan so that I can live in peace. You see, I want peace and security for my country, and for me, dealing with Pakistan, managing Pakistan is part of that thing. After all, when I look around, there are many issues I can't resolve the problem. You're right. Maybe the problem can't be resolved. But my challenge is to manage it to the lowest level of violence. Meaning, I must be able to manage it to the lowest level of violence. That is the challenge that I have. If you can do it some other way, do it by all means. But I'm saying, how do I protect this country? We are having guys, if there is another cycle of violence, again the bombers come, people get, in this city, I've lost a relative to a terrorist blast in Connaught Place. I had another relative who was almost, my cousin sitting there, his father has actually seen a terrorist aim at him in Chittaranjan Park, this city, in Delhi. So I want security for my country, a secure periphery for my country where my country can rise, do well economically. So it's my challenge, no one else's challenge.
Why is it not pandits in Srinagar being provided security?
Yeah. See, the point is that the whole pandit issue, I often talk to pandits, and the pandits have declared that January 19th is Holocaust Day, thing like that. And I was looking at the figures I had, and the figures I had showed me that yes, there were pandits who were killed. There's no doubt, and some of them were killed with a great deal of brutality. But in terms of numbers, to term it as a Holocaust, I think is stretching the facts beyond the point, because the figures I had was something like, I'm not able to locate the point where those figures are, but it was 4 or 5 pandits were killed in Srinagar. No. I'm not saying that. I'm saying a certain fear psychosis. I'm not denying this fear psychosis. That on the night of January 19th, 1990, there were mass demonstrations in Srinagar. And, Islamist slogans, India, get out, that kind of stuff. So there was a fear psychosis. Jagmohanji, in his wisdom, said that no matter where you go in Kashmir, your job will be kept. So if you were sitting out there and you'd seen you heard that the guy in the other locality had been killed, which is true, that there were murders. So you'd say, let me go off to Jammu and stay there for a while. So people left, and somehow they never came back. And that story is even true today. So I have no problem in the sense that I think that the we are still pretty far from the settlement in Kashmir. We have not even approached a domestic settlement. So that pandit's returning, I can't be brave for that pandit and say ki aap chale jao, sab theek hoga, main CRPF guard wahan laga dunga. Anyone knows, it's like Harkishan Singh Surjit. I once met him during the Punjab terrorism time. I said, comrade, you don't seem to be worried about the Khadkus coming and shooting you. He said, this protection is not going to help me. If they are bent on shooting me, they'll kill me. So there is a limit to what kind of personal protection you can provide. I think one question was raised about the human rights and humiliation issue. All true. It's described in my book in great detail. The human rights violation, that's been a terrible record. And in particular, the record of the BSF was perhaps the worst. I know in the case that the army did punish many of its people. They gave, in fact, when I wrote this book, they gave me a printout of saying that this is the people. So I said, why don't you publicize it? Tell the people that our army, we act against this. But the army could not understand my viewpoint. I said that you have to tell the people in the world that, in our army, if you commit excesses, you get punished. But somehow they had the feeling no morale will be affected. I said morale is affected if you don't. Morale is affected when people shelter murderers or shelter rapists. That's when morale is affected. But if you talk to the General K.V. Krishna Rao, General Zaki and others, they were particular, very, very strict. The problem was that the BSF, and in some part, I don't blame the BSF, the government of India threw them there. and said, you go and now deal with the situation. Untrained, and in those days, even Lal Chowk, at night they would be just firing. The militants would just fire the AK-47s at the pickets of the BSF. So you're a BSF jawan inside there, you know, this vermin-ridden, it's a terrible place, and that night the people are just shooting away at your at that place, and you're constantly in that kind of tension. So I blame the government of India for sending in untrained, this unequipped, ill-equipped. You know, the ordinary jawan, there were no mine-proof vehicles. So what would they do? They would put sandbags at the bottom of the vehicle for some kind of protection. Even that famous patka, which was discovered, it was some local jawans fabricated it. This response of the state was as I, but then the state itself was tottering in New Delhi. That was the problem. Yeah.
We would like to hear Mr. Vohra, who has been at the helm of affairs for pretty long time, 10 years. So please.
What is the scope of a Netanyahu Xinjiang type option for Kashmir? As somebody says, there's no scope of talking to Pakistan. We do it ourselves. So what is the scope that the Indian state can carry out an option like the Israelis combined with the Chinese in Xinjiang?
See, the problem is that the Israelis have complete air superiority and complete intelligence dominance of the area around it, meaning Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Egypt. The Israelis' air force is supreme, and the Israeli they also intelligence dominance of that area. In our case, that's simply not true.
Dr. Joshi, my name is Vikram Behel. I'm a son of an army officer, retired army, late army officer, King's Commission. Worked and served under General Karyapa. We were, as a family, visiting when General Karyapa was in Delhi and staying in Gymkhana Club in 1963-64. My mother, father, and I happened to visit him when he was staying in one of the cottages there. And during this conversation that I was there as a small boy, 8 or 9, which I was there physically and I heard, General Karyapa made this point. So I'd like to share it with you and the audience. And this is how the conversation went. General Karyapa said that when the time came for the Indian Army under his command to repulse the raiders, at that point, Pandit Nehru said, no, stop now, we will accept the ceasefire because world opinion at the UN will be against us. So the army was under General Karyapa, had the intention and was in a position to repulse the raiders. It was our political leadership at that point which stopped. Otherwise, perhaps it would have been different. Secondly, if we take the Pulwama case right now, there is, from tomorrow onwards, if you read an article out, which will be put out by India Today, as of now it's being put out, they have contacted an Italian journalist who has mentioned that there is proof, she has been able to get her, from her sources, between 130 and 170 deaths in Balakot. So we must understand that when we have a standing army, a navy, and probably the fifth largest, the seventh largest in the world, capable of taking action, if the political leadership and if people like us turn around and say, no, let's back off, then you will have countries like Pakistan, controlled, the army which controls the ISI, then uses terrorists as a force multiplier to go into places like Kashmir and do the kind of acts that they do. This is the first time we have been able to manage the world opinion, give the proof, and give a sufficient rebuttal of what our capabilities are. So we must allow the players and participants to understand what we as a nation want to do. Not that we sit here and turn around and say, well, somebody was pointing a gun at me and I spoke to Surjit and he said, well, what will 45 people do?
Already you made your point.
You made your point.
Thank you.
Now, can I respond?
By all means.
Yeah.
No, I
just want to say, first of all, your sequencing of Kariappa is incorrect.
Wait,
please. The point is, I made the point about the ceasefire line that when Kariappa was going to take over, Kariappa had not taken over. So the ceasefire was declared before Kariappa had taken over the army. So that's the, please don't forget that, number one. Number two, you're talking of Moreno's article. This article, she has written it earlier. I just wonder how someone who's sitting in Italy has better information. This lady sitting in Italy knows that 170 people were killed in this Balakot thing better than sources in India or even sources in Pakistan. So wait. Now you made your point. You made your point. Now let me, I'm just responding to your point, you see. And the third point is that every single senior general I have met, corps commanders, particularly in Kashmir, and you can go back and Google things now, most of them have said, we've done our job. It's for the politicians to fix this problem. Most military people I have met with regard to the Kashmir issue have said, we've done our job, which is a fact. They have crushed the insurgency, they have defeated the insurgents. The issue is, the ball is in the court of the politicians. They must fix it. You can't have the army endlessly fighting this this cycle because the politicians are unable to do their job.
We'll finish. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you had a very good discourse. You heard Mr. Joshi. He's covered a very, very large spectrum of what has happened from 47 onwards, more particularly 88 to 98. And in the book, on being asked by one of the participants what is new about the new edition, he has told us what is new. I will not say very much to endorse or to subtract from what he has said. It's a very complex and a very complicated and a very long drawn out affair. Anybody can be right and anybody can be wrong by making this or that statement. But I think what he has said finally is that it has been a very long drawn out battle, long drawn out combat. And there are inherent limitations to what the uniformed forces can and cannot do. So there is a very specific and a very important role to be played by the political leaders of the countries involved in our case, particularly India and Pakistan. So if we determine to do that and the external circumstances don't impinge against our interests, then I feel quite convinced that it is not difficult. Somebody said here it's insoluble. I think it is soluble. There is nothing which is insoluble. We have to make a determined, conscious, well-considered effort which is sustained and it doesn't undergo variation after Manoj Joshi leaves and I have another view and after I leave somebody starts something new. I think we have to internally make up our mind of what we need to do. Then we have to bring around the leadership of the entire state of J&K, not merely the valley. There is the whole Ladakh region, which is 8 times larger than the rest of the valley, and the Jammu region, which is again a very vast region, and it is comprised by various communities. We have the Gujars, the Bakarwals, we have the non-Kashmiri Muslims, we have the Dogras and the Rajputs and the higher castes and the lower castes spread all over. So I think it is would be belittling the issue if you heard Mr. Joshi, and I think he's covered the whole ground fairly well. We can always disagree with him on some or the other point, but that would not lend to any purposeful outcome. So So I thank you, all of you, for your patience and for being with us this evening. Thank you. Joshi Sahab, once again, thank you.
Thank you.